Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Let Go Now, Embrace Detachment as a Path to Freedom, by Karen Casey, narrated by Vanessa Daniels. Preface. When Let Go Now was first published nearly a decade ago, it felt like one of the most important of all the books I had ever written. And it still feels that way. Each and every one of the thoughts included continues to ring true. I am inclined to think it's because the simple suggestion to let go now, of the behavior, the dreams and aspirations, and especially the opinions of others, continues to be an idea that I need to embrace. It takes practice, daily. Minding the business of others simply comes naturally, at least to some of us. A very good friend of mine often says, "There are two kinds of business, my business and none of my business." Although this is a clever comment, its wisdom is profound. Letting others conduct the business of their lives without our interference is a wise and mighty choice, one that's good for all parties. Detachment doesn't mean dissolution of any relationship, unless it's intentional. Nor does it mean absence of love or kindness. Detachment is allowing ourselves and anyone close to us to be as they are, without our interference. In other words, to kindly and gently detach from their journey, allowing them to find their own way while we travel our own path, too. I've come to believe that to let go and embrace detachment is the kindest, most loving thing we can do. It is the purest form of love that I know. Letting go isn't all that easy. The tension so easily observed between friends, colleagues, family members, and even between perfect strangers suggests this. But it's important, especially in times of chaos and strife, fear and uncertainty. The ability to let go just may be one of the most important things any one of us can do to improve the condition of our daily lives. To live and let live, that is our assignment. When we practice this, we will know peace. And those we let go of may just discover a glimmering of peace too. That may be the sweetest gift of all. I wrote this book for you and for me too. My inner voice guides every word I write, and I am comforted by this thought. How lucky for both of us. May our paths continue to cross. Karen Casey, 2019. Introduction. How do we embrace detachment? Why should we even want to? Those are questions that prompted my desire to write this book. Detachment, according to the dictionary, means separation. Embrace means to come together. How can we do both in the same moment? It's my intention to make this conundrum clear as you move through this book. In the meditations, you will come to understand not only the necessity for loving detachment within our many relationships, those that are dear to us, as well as those that cause us concern, but also the importance of embracing this concept if you want a peaceful journey through life. To begin with, I think we have to cultivate our willingness to let go, that is, to detach from the trials and tribulations of our contemporaries, if we want to find the quiet peace we long for, a peace that will allow us to truly love, to truly embrace, and to appreciate those who journey with us. In this process, we also give those companions the freedom to grow and to find their own way, thus their own eventual peace too. I don't think we can come together as loving equals without embracing the willingness to detach. We live very codependent lives, from my perspective. By this, I mean that too many of us let even the whims of others, in our families, our communities, our workplaces, even in other parts of the world, define us, determine how we feel, and then decide what we will do next in many instances. Learning to detach allows us to live the life we were meant to live. By allowing other people's behavior, good, bad, or disinterested, control us, we miss many opportunities for movement and expression in new directions. The converse is also true. If we attempt to control the other persons on our path, wherever they may reside, keeping them attached to us through any means, and most of us are very practiced at this, we immobilize them, thus preventing the growth they deserve and have been prepared for already. Detachment isn't easy. If it were, there would be no need for a book offering to help you develop the skills to do it. And it may not have appeared on your radar screen as something you wanted to cultivate prior to picking up this book. As was already noted, we are accustomed to being enmeshed with others, letting our lives be constantly influenced by their behavior. I am not suggesting that this influence is always bad. There are good influences too, probably every day. We can and do observe healthy, detached behavior in some of our friends, and perhaps they showed up on our path to serve as our teachers. It's not always easy to discern the good from the bad, however. It's my intent for the meditations here to illustrate those behaviors we want to mimic and those we don't. It is my hope that this book, Let Go Now, Embrace Detachment as a Path to Freedom, will clarify many of your questions about detachment, what it is, how to do it, and how to practice it with others. It's also my hope that you will give yourself all the time you need to fully absorb the concepts and to develop the skills as outlined. I didn't come to appreciate the value of detachment easily, and the idea of embracing it came even later. But the peaceful tenor of my journey today is surely the result of my commitment to practicing and embracing detachment at every opportunity. I believe that every moment of our lives is offering us just such an opportunity. And wherever we are, others are on hand to observe, to reap the benefit of our practice, and to carry what they have seen into their own lives. How to use this book. After hearing my story about detachment, about how and why I came to realize I needed help, and about the transformation that has happened in my life, go to the meditations. Don't listen to them all at once. Savor them. Meditate on them. Listen to one a day, or spread one of them over a 2 or 3 day period. There really is no hurry. It's a practice that actually has no ending point. What I am suggesting is this. There is no one way, no right way to use this book. It's yours to use in whatever way makes the most sense for you. Only you and your higher power know what's best for you. As you move through the book, you will note that following every 10 meditations is a pause and reflection. At these points, I suggest you get a journal and share your thoughts, as triggered by my comments, for your own growing success with this ever-so-important skill, a skill that, if mastered, I promise will change every moment of the rest of your life. You will also note that I have repeated myriad times many of the specific ideas from various perspectives. That's very intentional. If you are like me, it takes more than one explanation, more than a single consideration to grasp a new idea. I think these ideas are important enough that they bear repeating. Good luck with this book. You and those you travel with will benefit by all that you accomplish. Blessings to you on your journey. My story. I want to begin with my own story as an illustration of what it was like before I understood detachment, what happened, and what it's like now that I am committed to the practice of detachment on a daily basis. My journey has been quite miraculous, I think, but what happened to me is certainly attainable by others. Anyone who is imprisoned by codependence, by attachment to others, will be able to relate. What I want all people to know is that life can become all that you want it to be, all that you dreamed of at some earlier time in your life. It certainly is not possible that what I learned was for my soul edification. As a young girl growing up in a dysfunctional family, I became very skilled at reading the body language of others to see if I was okay. I didn't get many signs of approval. My parents struggled in their relationship, and my dad's anger, coupled with my mom's sadness, permeated the household. I tiptoed around the rage when possible, and then as I got older, I raged too. At age 13, I discovered the marvelous effects of alcohol from a glass of Coke spiked with whiskey that I surreptitiously mixed at a family wedding reception. From that day until May 24, 1976, I used alcohol to change the way my life looked and felt. But between the first drink and the last, some 23 years later, I was to undergo many traumas. The majority of them were complicated by my dependence on men, right along with my dependence on alcohol and other drugs. I simply had mastered my ability to read another's every mood, and that became my mood too. I was soon imprisoned by the behaviors of others, and then I tried to control those behaviors, which I was sure was possible and furthermore would allow me to feel okay about myself and the relationship. Alas, it was not possible. My sense of isolation escalated and my grip on alcohol tightened. Not surprising, my first marriage ended, one that I had been sure would provide me with the security I sought. Neither of us understood the effects of the alcohol on our lives. I didn't choose to see the effects even then, and instead sought other relationships that also had alcohol as the glue. One relationship followed another, none of them mirroring the dream I had crafted for myself. But all the relationships had one thing in common: my inability to allow the other person to have a life of his own. Thus, I had no real life either. I clung and harped and cried and used alcohol to feed the dark hole inside me. Then I was introduced to Al-Anon, where the miracle actually began. I didn't very readily get the message being conveyed, but the joy I observed drew me back, week after week. I knew I wanted what the others in that room seemed to have, and they kept saying, "Keep coming back." I did, contentedly so. Eventually, I began couples counseling with my significant other, a man who never once had time to come to our sessions. This should have been a red flag, but I simply didn't want to acknowledge what I suspected it meant. The counselor eventually sought to hear my story anyway and sent me straight to Alcoholics Anonymous. It was there that my life got both better and worse. My dependence on men, any man, seemed like the solution to me. Even though I wasn't using alcohol anymore to fill the dark hole, I was relying on the attention of men to have the same effect. The emotional insanity was crippling. Because I was still going to Al-Anon, I was trying to manage my feelings around others, but my success was limited. And then my sponsor said, "Stay out of relationships with men for a year and find out who you are, Karen." I complied, not very happily at first, but her words rang true. I still didn't cotton to most of the suggestions I was hearing in either Al-Anon or AA, but eventually my willingness grew. All I knew for sure was that others in the group knew more than I did, and I wanted what many of them had. Being told that my life did not need to revolve around the moods, the actions, the dreams, the failures, or the successes of anyone else was information I simply didn't know how to absorb. I had always danced around others. I knew no other dance. For quite a spell, I was at a loss, sitting on the sidelines. But then the messages I was hearing began to penetrate. I was enough, they said. I didn't need the approval of anyone else. I had a God in whom I could trust to guide my every action, a God who loved me, flaws and all. Then the messages, the principles that ultimately led to my grip on the meaning of detachment, thankfully multiplied. Wherever we are, God is present. Whoever comes our way is part of our learning curve. We have the power to change how we think. Appreciating the journey of everyone else is what gives my own journey purpose. Peaceful feelings follow peaceful actions. The chaos of others need not attract us. No argument demands our participation. Acting rather than reacting is blissful. To witness another's journey is all we are ever called to do. Our teachers are everywhere. Silence may be the best response we can make in myriad situations. There are two kinds of business: your business and none of your business. Taking no hostages is the surest way to peace. I have hung on to every one of these messages for dear life at one time or another, and to many more that I illustrate in the meditations that follow. They each became part of my lifeline to sanity. They still are part of my lifeline. My understanding of detachment and its value as the way to a peaceful heart and journey is encased in each and every one of them. For more than 30 years, I have worked to master these principles. I have been more successful with some than with others. But my journey is not finished. That's the great news I celebrate every day when I wake up. I have all the time I need to seek and enjoy the fruits of this journey. Willingness comes first. Application of the principles comes next. And gratitude to God and the hovering angels for helping me is never to be forgotten. What any one of us does today pays forward in someone's life tomorrow. And we are an interconnected whole. Whomever we help by our actions in this moment will be available to help others tomorrow. I have loved claiming my small part in the unending circle of peaceful living. You can claim your part too. The world will be made better by the efforts of all of us. Meditations. 1. Detachment is simply watching the events that are unfolding around you, getting involved only when your journey is part of the experience. Not reacting to the people or the situations that so easily attract our attention is not an easy skill to develop. And a skill it is. We must practice driving and chipping and putting a golf ball in order to be good golfers. We have to hit thousands of tennis balls against a backdrop to play tennis competitively. And we have to sit for long, long hours at the piano keys in order to become proficient pianists. We would not expect to be very good at any one of these activities without practice. Lots of it. But we seldom grasp, until after many failures, sometimes years of failures, that we have to practice and rehearse again and again the art of not reacting, of detaching, from the actions of those around us. How often we hear, or worse yet, say, "He made me do it." Wrong. No one can make us do anything. Only we have the power to do or not do whatever we do. That's the good news, in fact. We are in charge of ourselves. No one else's. The freedom that accompanies this realization will lift our spirits throughout the day. Getting involved in the actions of others isn't in my best interests, most of the time. I will walk away when I need to today. 2. Detachment is stepping back from an experience in order to allow room for God to do his or her part. I seldom remember, without some prodding, that I initially resist, that God is a factor in every person's experience. My ego's first inclination is to think that I am a necessary factor. Not just an ordinary necessary factor, but the deciding one, in the lives of my friends and family. Giving up control and letting God be the key influence in the lives of my loved ones is not easy. It takes trust. Not only trust in God, but also trust in others and in my own willingness to approach my experiences with all of them differently. The benefit of coming to believe that God is the key factor in everyone's life is that it releases us from a heavy burden. Too many of us have tried to manage the lives of too many others for far too long. No one gains in that scenario. On the contrary, everyone loses the peace that comes with turning our lives over to the care and guidance of a loving God. Keeping a mental note of all the times I step away from an experience that isn't mine to control will fill me with a sense of empowerment. What a great opportunity this will be today. 3. Detachment promises quiet contentment. Choosing contentment over agitation seems like a simple choice, but it apparently isn't for many of us. All we have to do is take a brief inventory of the many encounters we had yesterday. How many of them were peaceful? Did we take the high road very often? Were a few of those encounters riddled with words or actions that embarrass us in retrospect? Were there some we regret yet today? It's been my experience that the encounters that are not peaceful fall into two categories. First, there are those that are the direct result of my trying to make something my business that is not my business. In other words, of my trying to control that which is not mine to control. The other category can best be described as letting someone else's behavior determine how I feel about myself. This becomes a cesspool, and I have wallowed in it far too many times. Fortunately, I am learning to make better choices. Now I can walk away most of the time when I need to. How about you? The first few times we make the choice to be peaceful rather than right, it feels like denial. But with practice, it will become the preferred choice. Give it a try today. 4. Detachment is making no one a project. It's my guess that since you have found this book of interest, you are able to relate to some of the struggles I have had over the years. One of these is dancing around the life of someone else, rather than leading my own life. I am pleased to say I have made a lot of progress in this arena, but for many decades, I didn't know there was any other way to live. If someone else wasn't at the center of my life, I wasn't sure who I was. What a sad existence. What a sad recollection, too. Not letting someone else determine who we are or what we think or how we feel is revelatory when first encountered as an idea. I was introduced to this notion in 1971 in a book titled Why Am I Afraid to Tell You Who I Am? By John Powell. I immediately embraced the philosophy, even though I knew it was a truth I was not yet able to practice. Now, many years later, I realize that we are often given the seed of an idea long before it's able to sprout real growth in our own lives. The fortunate thing is that we are never the same after the idea first presents itself. I am my only project. Fully embracing this idea gives me so much freedom to do the many things I have been born to do. Others are in our lives for a reason, but they are not present as our works in progress. 5. Detachment means taking no hostages. Perhaps you have never thought that your obsession with another person might be defined as hostage-taking. Historically, we think of hostages as those people who are imprisoned, particularly in a time of war. However, we can slide quite easily into making a friend or loved one a hostage of sorts by our attempts to control their every move. Our smothering focus can be likened to making them our prisoner. But since the natural inclination of every prisoner is to want to flee, the outcome of our behavior will never give us the result we are seeking. Why is it that we are so determined to control someone else? I have given this a lot of consideration for the past few years and have concluded that our need to control others grows out of our own insecurity. We fear abandonment, perhaps, or simple rejection at least. Both will become the reality if we insist on keeping our focus on them rather than on us. Making the decision to change our focus is an available option. While having a hostage might make us feel secure momentarily, we can always expect them to try to escape. That's the natural inclination. Is that really how we want to live? 6. Detachment means giving up outcomes. Perhaps you have heard this wise phrase, "Our job is the effort, not the outcome." But how often do we embrace it fully? Generally, we want to secure the result that we have imagined is the perfect one. To do this, we assume that we have to shepherd the project or the situation or the person down the path that leads to our definition of the natural conclusion. But the correct conclusion, God's will, might not even resemble our will. That's not an easy adjustment to make in our thinking. Hindsight is so revealing. For just a moment, recall a situation in your past that you were determined to control, but the outcome was simply not what you had envisioned. Can you see how much better God's outcome was? In my life, had I managed to make happen many of my educated choices, I'd not be alive to write this book. Thank goodness my higher power had a far better outcome for me than my own. Now I know, even though I am still inclined to forget, that doing my part and then letting go of the rest will ensure, at the very least, my peace of mind. I like that feeling. Detaching from outcomes, those that apply to us and those that apply to the actions of others, is the surest way to a peaceful day. Trying is believing. 7. Detachment is letting the solutions be determined by God. Solutions are seldom simple. Perhaps that's because they generally involve other people too. When any one of us is certain that we have the best solution for any problem or situation confronting us, we have quite naturally chosen one that benefits us. There's nothing wrong with that stance. However, it may not be the best solution for all the people who are affected by the situation. Backing off and letting God be a participant in every decision results in an outcome that offers us peace of mind and the most beneficial solution for all. If only we could remember that our higher power is a willing participant, we might call him or her the troubleshooter for every situation we encounter. We don't ever have to figure out anything alone. God would prefer otherwise, in fact. We need not ever make plans without consultation with the one who always knows the best direction for us to take. Our higher power is like having a GPS at our constant disposal that will, without fail, get us to our right destination. Always. And we can enjoy peace of mind. Always. Giving detachment a chance today will be like getting a paid vacation. We don't need to attend to situations that belong to others, and we can let God be part of every situation that does involve us. What relief we will feel! 8. Detachment is understanding that we are never the cause of someone else's actions. We live in a society that wants to blame others for every unfortunate situation that befalls us. Taking responsibility for the experiences we have, particularly when they are unpleasant, is not behavior that comes naturally to us. Most of us likely pattern our ideas and attitudes after those we observed in our homes. Our parents mimicked their parents too, no doubt. So this habit has had a long life. It controls how most of us see and think and behave. It also has colored the attitudes of the people with whom we are sharing our journey. But it's time to stop this merry-go-round of blame. No one can cause us to act in a particular way, and we are not to blame for anyone else's actions either. Others' actions are theirs, and solely theirs. Likewise, our choices about how to behave are ours. We might influence others, or even be influenced, but the final decision about how one acts falls with the one acting. We may not be all too happy about taking full responsibility for ourselves in every instance, nor in relinquishing the responsibility for how others behave. But we will grow accustomed to this, and it will free us from many burdens. Time will prove this to be true. Not having to be responsible for anyone but ourselves is a new way of seeing for many of us. Today can be peace-filled if we revel in this understanding. 9. Detachment is getting over it, whatever it is. The insanity of hanging on to those situations or recollections that disturbed our well-being, sometimes of occurrences that happened years ago, thinking that if we just figure them out, we can change the people or the outcome, is far too familiar. I speak from experience. How often I have let the behavior of others take control of my emotions or my actions. My memories of a past slight or an imagined slight can easily be conjured up, and my feelings can be hurt, or I can feel angry all over again. How embarrassing to admit this after all the years I have been making this spiritual journey. But alas, it's true, and I think it may occasionally be true for others, too. This is not about living perfectly. It's about making progress, even a bit of progress, as regularly as possible. My struggle with acceptance has been the big issue lately. I simply have forgotten that it's not my job to change others or to even expect others to change. My job is to accept people as they are, knowing that their journey is exactly as it needs to be for them, as is mine. We are always where we need to be on this path. We are always traveling with those we need to travel with. Period. There are no accidents, ever. I will accept whatever is happening as part of the plan for me today. With God's help, I can be fully accepting. 10. Detachment frees up our time. When we are involved in the plans, the problems, the details, and the actions of others, whether friend, spouse, or child, we have less time to attend to our own lives. Many of us think that part of our assignment here is being available to whomever and whatever their focus is. But that's not true. Not ever true, in fact. As parents, we may need to closely supervise the activities of our children, but we shouldn't limit our focus to that alone. Our lives are, or can be, much richer than our role as parent or spouse or friend. Our attention must remain on those things that have called to us and only us on our journey. Perhaps detachment was an unfamiliar concept to you before picking up this book. When I first heard the word, I struggled to understand its meaning. I deciphered it by going through the door of attachment, actually. I did know how it felt to be attached to someone else. I had tried to keep loved ones attached to me for years. Coming to see that detachment was letting go, releasing others to make their own choices, their own mistakes, to realize their own dreams, initially felt like loneliness to me. My life simply had been a dance around others. Letting them be meant I was dancing alone. But then I discovered the freedom I had to actually move in ways that pleasured me, and joy replaced the tension that had haunted me for years. At last. There will always be enough time to do what I am being called to do when I keep my attention where it belongs, on me. Pause and reflect. To detach is not unloving. It's giving space to our loved ones to grow. It's the kindest gift we can give a friend. It's the kindest gift we can give to ourselves. Think of some situations over the past few days in which you successfully freed someone from your hold on them. Journal for a few minutes to strengthen your resolve. Think of your own feeling of freedom when you let go. What did it feel like? Are you committed to seeking more of this feeling? Journal about the growth you seek and the growth you have already attained with letting go. 11. Detachment simplifies our life. Closely monitoring one life is really quite enough. Paying too close attention to someone else's life will only upset the balance of our own. We have the energy to live one life, not two or more. It's God's work to orchestrate the lives of others. Why are we so insistent on taking on more than we have been selected to do? Could it be that we are afraid others will leave us behind if we aren't wrapped up in their plans, their daily activities, their dreams for the future? Having a simpler life, one that concerns itself with only our activities, is really so refreshing, so energizing, so peaceful. Until we remove our attention from the machinations of others, we can't even get a sense of what having more energy, extended periods of peace, and the joy that comes with detachment feels like. But once we have allowed ourselves to know this feeling, we will hunger for it more and more. In time, we will seek the freedom of detachment on a daily basis, and on a daily basis, we will live peacefully. Being peaceful and enjoying the simple life doesn't have to elude us. Keeping our focus where it belongs is the method for attaining this peace. Today is the right day to seek it. 12. Detachment is an acquired habit. Obsession with the actions of others, wishing he or she would change, wanting more attention or perhaps less, wishing our significant others would let us decide their fate, is so exhausting. When we are caught up in the cycle of obsession, we are seldom even aware of how we are letting our own lives slip away. But slip away they will. Learning how to let go of others and their lives takes willingness, a tremendous commitment to staying the course, and constant practice. If we don't keep this as a goal for our lives, we will miss the opportunities God is sending us for our own unique growth. We can only do justice to one life, ours. Being detached from someone does not mean no longer caring for them. It does not mean pretending they no longer exist. It does not mean avoiding all contact with them. Being detached simply means not letting their behavior determine our feelings. It means not letting their behavior determine how we act, how we think, how we pray. Detachment is a loving act for all concerned. No one wants to be the constant center of someone else's life, at least not for long. Two people lose their lives when either one is constantly focused on the other. That's not why we are here. We can journey together today. From the shared journey, we learn. But being enmeshed with another rather than complementing another's journey will destroy both parties. I will keep this in my memory bank today. 13. Detachment means freedom from obsession. I, for one, am all too familiar with how obsessing over the actions of others can cause my emotions to spin out of control. Left unchecked, I can find myself in a downward spiral that feels overwhelming and can lead to the awful feeling of hopelessness that used to be a constant companion. Obsession with others on our path can creep up on us when least expected. But I have come to understand, with the help of those wiser than myself on this journey, that when I am not staying close enough to my higher power, I am very vulnerable to the old habit of watching others and letting how they behave determine how I feel. I have been on this spiritual journey for many decades, actually for my whole life when I acknowledged that God was always present even when I was unable to acknowledge it. And yet, I can slip away from the very habits that keep me serene, sane, and living in the joy that is my birthright. I am quite certain the same is true for many of you. We can learn how to detach. We can think about God rather than about what someone else is doing or not doing. Moving our thoughts from one to the other is the key to happiness. It's guaranteed. Being lovingly detached is the best way to honor one another's journey. Everyone is here for a specific set of lessons. We must allow everyone to follow his or her own inner guidance to learn their lessons. 14. Detachment is knowing that what others do is not a reflection on you. When our companions act out or treat us poorly in public, when our friends or partners are rude or ill-behaved in any way, it's easy to think that others are judging us along with our partner for whatever he or she has done, particularly if we have been guilty of this form of judgment ourselves. I don't think we instinctively know that another person's behavior reflects solely on them, never on us. If others do judge us for someone else's behavior, it's generally because they are enmeshed in the actions of others themselves. Having good boundaries with the people on our journey requires daily attention. Because we know others are sharing our journey for the lessons we are both here to learn, it's easy to slip over the line that actually separates what any one of us individually needs to master. We aren't separate from one another in the spiritual sense, but that's another matter. Let's not confuse the two. When we do, others' actions and choices get in the way of your peace of mind, and neither of us can find the joy that has been promised us. Defining our boundaries with others serves both of us. It assures us that we will never get entrapped in emotions that belong to someone else. 15. Detachment is not making a big deal of situations, even complicated ones. When I was whining for the umpteenth time about a situation over which I had no control, a good friend said, "So what?" I was initially startled, miffed, and even slightly hurt, but soon realized that she had done me a great service. I was creating a drama over a very minor, though often repeated, situation. And the reality is, we don't need to dramatize even major situations. When we allow God into the mix of the resolution, calm can prevail. As I have matured, calm has become far more attractive to me. Knowing that I can feel peace instead of this has been a life-saving mantra. The only problem is that I have to remember to use it. Periodically, I slide into old behavior and let what's happening around me influence how I am feeling. When my emotions get triggered by what I am seeing others do or hearing what others are saying, I have given up my own life for the moment. Their actions or words may not make me angry, but they can create my reality for that moment. With practice, I can remember to create my own reality, and I'm far better for it. Creating my own reality is an excellent undertaking every moment of the day. Unless I am in the flow of detaching from others, my reality will be clouded by their behavior. 16. Detachment empowers us. The gift of empowerment comes every time we let someone else decide his or her fate. Even the tiny decision someone might be struggling with doesn't need our input unless asked for. This is not an easy realization to come to grips with. So much of our persona may well be tied to having our friends or family members mirror our choices. And yet, when we lay that expectation on them, or simply hold that expectation quietly within, we will experience chaos. No one wants to be controlled. Even when we are subtle about it, it's recognized and resisted. You may be wondering what empowerment feels like if this is a new concept to you. It's probably best understood in terms of synonyms. It's freedom. It's peace of mind. It's not feeling absorbed by the antics of others. It's clarity of thinking. It's a feeling of lightness throughout the body. It's having the time to be joyful and unencumbered. It's having the sense that our higher power is close. Detachment is truly a gift of great proportions. Nothing can be well attended to when our emotions are attached to the actions of others. Today, I will become willing to let God, not my companions, be the center of my life. 17. Detachment frees us from overreaction. Overreacting to the myriad situations in my life, whether bona fide major ones or extremely minor incidents, was once standard practice. Maybe you can relate. It made little difference what my spouse or a friend or coworker did. I was capable of taking their actions or words quite personally, and then acting in ways that were seldom fitting for the situation. The idea of considering how I wanted to respond and then actually responding in a sane way had never occurred to me. For decades, I had watched my family of origin react to whatever happened, and I was a great imitator. Learning that there is another way to see, to interpret, to respond, is like being given a second chance at life. We are on this path with others because of what we each have to learn. We are journeying together, intentionally. We are not making the journey for each other or as each other. Doing for others what they need to do for themselves prevents the learning that needs to occur, both ours and theirs. Stepping aside and watching others handle that which is theirs to handle, and not letting what they do determine how we feel, is the real stuff of this journey. Discovering this makes every minute pretty exciting. Making the decision to thoroughly enjoy this or any other day is pretty simple. It relies on our willingness to not let the actions of others take over our minds. We are in charge of what we think, what we say, what we do.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.